Kind of Well, we're so thankful for you. This last week we celebrated Thanksgiving, and one of the greatest gifts that God can give to a church is a man who is faithful, a man who is certainly helps us and leads us congregationally with music and our orchestra and our choir. And Pastor Brandon has been so very, very faithful. In fact, thinking about this, Pastor Brandon was here, has been here since you were a newlywed. They basically, he and Miss Amy got married, and then, was it a month or so? And then not too long, you guys ended up here. Right? That was a long time ago. 2 weeks. Got married in 2 weeks. They were here.
Oh, man.
And that's an exciting thing. So they've been here a very long time. And Pastor Brandon, will you remember that Proverbs 20:29 says this, the glory of young men is their strength, and the beauty of old men is their gray head. And so we just wanted to celebrate with you today. And we remember, thinking about your birthday, we have a few things, again, that I want to give to you this morning, that our church wanted to give to you this morning, just to remind you about how well you are aging so gracefully and to aid you in these years ahead. The first thing I'd like to give to you is a magnifying glass. And this is to help you when it comes to help you keep studying the Bible and leading music with those aging eyes that you have. And so we want to give that to you this morning, and we know that you're going to need that certainly soon. You don't already need it, but we think about this as well, and I know you're sitting there in that handy-dandy wheel contraption, and you might need this. We have a gift certificate to Golden Age Nursing Home, and this will help you. And in fact, this certifies that Brandon Osborne, you complete the training program and requirements for a free tour in preparation in the near future at Golden Age. So we wanted to give that to you this morning. And we're so thankful again for you today to celebrate. And of course, you know, we think about, you know, sometimes when you got to go, you got to go. We wanted to help you with that. And so we have some prune juice for you this morning to make sure, you know, just to make sure you stay pretty regular and on time with things. That's a good and important thing there as well. And then, of course, I know you may have some oil stuff, but I hear some of the older people recommend this, too. And this is Ben Gay. For the town folks, let's make sure that the whole service stays regular today. Amen? And so there's some Ben Gay. That's for all those aches and pains that you're going to get. I don't need that stuff yet. And then we have vitamins. Vitamins are so important. And I know you told me about vitamins and things along the way, but this is Centrum Silver, okay? This is specific for your new age requirements, and we want to make sure that doctor recommended, and so a little commercial there. So Centrum Anti-Aging Vitamins, and that's to help keep you looking younger each and every year. And then, of course, I don't know if you need this quite yet, but this is just for when you need it. This is denture cleaning cream, okay? And so just some paste right there just to make sure that you have just a beautiful smile like you always do. And we're so thankful for that great smile that we've seen. And then, I know you head up our Sunday school department. And so we wanted to give you something special from our Sunday school department. This is a special certificate, because you now have honorary membership to the Young at Hearts Sunday School class. Amen? We love you. Now, you even had your picture on there, didn't it? Yeah, let's do this just for a second, and we're just going to take a little trip down memory lane. Some of you have been here for a short time. Some of you have been here the entire time. The Osbornes have been here.
Oh, yeah.
And so as we kind of dim the lights here a little bit, we're going to show a short video. And you can look back at a few of the pictures and some of the memories of Pastor Brandon, some from before he was here and many from while during his ministry while he's been here at Open Door Baptist Church, with a little bit of wisdom from Mark Lowry and a special song that he wrote and sings to us this morning.
They don't hurt me, that's for sure. Get up early.
Oh, there I am.
They don't have to anymore. They'll keep that old car shining.
for you this morning, and this morning certainly we want to recognize that, and tonight as well. And tonight we'll have our prayer time and our business meeting, and then after that we'll also have our fellowship time. So I'm going to invite your church family to be back this evening to celebrate with cake. Amen. And it's a great time, a great week. I know we had a lot of pie this week, and a lot of stuffing and all that good stuff. We're just going to keep on celebrating. How many of you know when you know Jesus, you just keep on celebrating? Amen. And tonight we're going to continue that celebration, certainly thanking the Lord for what God has blessed us with as a church family, with Pastor Brandon. Pastor Brandon, we're so thankful for you. We love you, and we look forward to what God's going to continue to do in your life as you continue to serve him faithfully with all that you are. If you would, we're going to have a word of prayer. We do that this morning, and we'll ask God to bless, and I'll have a word of prayer this morning. We'll lead us this morning, and then after I pray, then Pastor Brandon, the new and improved Pastor Brandon, will lead our choir this morning as we sing, as they sing this morning. Would you pray with me this morning to open our service? Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can lift up your name. We thank you that we can honor you, and we thank you for the faithfulness of your servants. As we think about what you're going to do in our service today, so many people have worked and striven to help today, and so many other opportunities in the past and the future to go so well. And Lord, we thank you for the servants that you have blessed us with, and one of those that we are thankful for today, especially for Pastor Brandon, and we thank you for his 40th birthday. We just ask that you would bless him with many, many more. Lord, help him to continue to be successful in your work as he strives to honor and to glorify you. Lord, please bless our service today. Lord, help us to draw our hearts to you. Lord, help us to grow in you. May you help us to look into your word, that you would help this to be a turning point in all of our lives as we look into your word, as your Holy Spirit meets with us and challenges our hearts to live for you. Lord, please do a great work this morning, and Lord, help us to anticipate that great work even now. Lord, we love you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Unholy, for the broken, love that song. Listen, I do want to say thank you for mentioning me on my birthday, recognizing it. I've really appreciated serving here. I know, Pastor, I don't know if you were able to do that speaking from experience or if you grabbed that from your own personal stash, but I do appreciate you that doing that. But I know you've been here a little while and you've seen hair and seen it go by as well as me. You've seen a lot of changes over the years. And I appreciate doing ministry with you. Some of you I've known all of those 16 years that we've been here, and some of you just a few years, but whatever it is, you've made an impact on my life, my family's life, and I have just enjoyed doing ministry here, doing ministry alongside of you, the choir serving alongside of you, many of you in Sunday school, and so thank you for serving faithfully alongside of me, and I'm looking forward. I feel young. I don't feel old. I know I look old. But I still feel young, so thank you for that. Right now, what we're going to do, young people, first through sixth grade, you can head on back to Children's Church. I have a great King's Kids program going on back there, so if this is your first time and you'd like to step back there with them for a little while, you can do that just to see what goes on. Everyone else, would you stand up, turn around, greet one another, and we're going to come back and sing in just a little bit.
Your name is a strong and mighty time.
pray as we've been together, Lord, that truly you've been honored, Lord, and that you've heard not just from our lips, but you've heard from our heart. Lord, worship. And I pray that you'll bless as we come together and hear your word preached this morning. I pray you'll speak to our hearts. You'll change us as we have an opportunity to look into your living word. We love you, and we thank you for loving us. It's in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
last week, and praise the Lord for that. Thank you very much for reminding us about the sound of God's great name. And in fact, they just sang several parts of God's name, if you will, different reminders of who God is. And one that we turn to, we think about this time of the year, is certainly the name of Jesus. Remember that Jesus is the Savior. And we're going to be focusing on Jesus Christ the next few weeks as we focus on Christmas time. And you can see that, in fact, for a little while, the stores have already been pretty much ready for Christmas. And now we're getting ready for Christmas here and excited about the opportunities that we have to point people to Jesus Christ. If you would open your Bibles this morning, we'll be looking at Luke chapter number 1 today. And focusing on several different characters. In fact, as we prepare for Christmas time, we look into the Christmas story, which is recorded for us, specifically in two books of the Bible, Matthew and Luke. And so those two books, over the next few weeks, we'll be noting and looking at, trying to look at some of the stories and some of the people who have been involved. And I'm sure if you were one of the people who were involved, you would have had some questions in your life. So that's what we're going to be looking at. We're going to be asking some of the questions and trying to answer some of the questions that were asked by some of these characters as they went through this time of life in the world. And so certainly, we think of Christmas time, and it is full of sounds, is it not? And we think of the hurry of feet shopping. We think of cash registers dinging. We think of sleigh bells ringing. Are you listening, right? And we like get ready. Not that we have a whole lot of sleighs down here that are going to ride on the snow, but we think about them anyway. We sing about them. And people ask that song. How many of you know that song? Do you hear what I hear? Right? And there's an old Christmas song along the way. And when you think about it, the hustle and bustle is certainly reminded of that this busy time of the year. And the question is this: because we are so busy, is it possible that we may miss out on what God is trying to say? I think sometimes we get so busy, do we not, that we're not always listening to the right voices. We're not always tuned in to what it is that God wants to say. Have you ever wondered what God's voice sounds like? I have many, many different times. And by the way, it probably does not sound like what Charlton Heston or something like that. We think about these different movies where they have a voice booming from heaven, and it may be a booming voice. We see God's voice described in Scripture several different ways, but none of us have ever heard the actual voice of God. But we think of some of these Christmas stories in the Word of God, and we can see that different people did hear the voice of God along the way. Think about this. If you could hear God speak, what would he be trying to tell you? And by the way, let me just kind of tip you off and remind you that God is trying to speak, and we need to be listening for what it is that God's trying to tell us. Let me kind of set the stage a little bit for you. We're looking here in Luke chapter number 1. About 2,400 years ago, God stopped talking, at least here on earth, to people. And he wrote the last book of the Old Testament named Malachi, and basically here's what he said. Here's how he concluded Malachi 4, verses 5 and 6. He said, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord, and he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse." So that was 2,400 years ago, and then about 400 years, there was about 400 silent years until God finally spoke again, and he was preparing to fulfill this prophecy that we saw here in Malachi 4, as well as many others, and many generations passed not hearing the voice of God, not hearing from God. There was no new prophecy spoken. There was no new scripture that was inspired during that period of time. And God's people were going through the motions, but God wasn't speaking any new messages. So there were no new prophets, and the priests just went on doing their normal duties. But none of them knew what it was like to hear from God. And then God broke the silence. And he sent the angel Gabriel to a priest named Zacharias and his wife Elizabeth. Now, we start to look at the Word of God today, and if you would stand with me, we'll read in Luke chapter number 1, and we'll read verses 57 to verse number 66. Now, we start to look at the passage, and we're really looking pretty much at the whole chapter. You can see it's 80 verses. There's a segment in there that we're not going to read this morning, but we look at the passage today, and I hope this will encourage you to be thinking about this great truth when God broke his silence. God broke his silence. So we look here at the Word of God. In Luke 1, verse number 57, and it says this: "Now Elizabeth's full time came that she should be delivered, and she brought forth a son." Now we're going to go back to earlier in the passage, you're going to note this, that the angel Gabriel came and told her and Zacharias that they were going to have a baby in their old age. And so when it came to this story, it's like, wow, they're pretty excited about it. And so here's the fulfillment of that promise. Verse 58, and her neighbors and her cousin heard how the Lord had showed great mercy upon her, and they rejoiced with her. And it came to pass that on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zacharias after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said, not so, but he shall be called John. And they said unto her, there is none in thy kindred that is called by this name. And they made signs to his father how he would have him called. And he asked for a writing table and wrote, saying, his name is John. And they marveled all. You say, why was he just talking? Why did he have to write it down? Well, we'll see that in the early part of the story. For this 9-month period of time, we can see that Zacharias was not able to speak. God made him not be able to speak for this period of time. And we can see after he said his name is John, and they marveled, verse 63. Verse 64, and his mouth was opened immediately, and his tongue loosed, and he spake, and what did he do? He praised God. Now, how many of you, if you weren't able to talk for 9 months, how many of you would be praising God too, right? And so he was praising God. Verse 64, and fear came on all that dwelt around them, and all these things were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of Judea. And all they that heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, what manner of child shall this be? And the hand of the Lord was with him. This morning we look and see an amazing event that happened. When we think about this question, if somebody was silent for a long time, and then they suddenly spoke again, how many of you would sit up and pay attention? We can see for a period of time, for 400 years, that God did not speak, and then he broke the silence to talk to this man, Zacharias, and then he made Zacharias not be able to speak. For 9 months, he wasn't able to speak, but then he did speak, and we can see that God used that to get the attention of the people around. And by the way, God uses some of the silence to get our attention. This morning, I want to encourage you to ask this question. What is God saying? What is God trying to say to you? What is God trying to tell our community? What is God trying to tell our church? We must listen. And in fact, the next few weeks, we're going to see some of the specific things that God says, not just to Zacharias and to Elizabeth, but also to several other characters in the Word of God as we think about the very first Advent, the very first Christmas story. And so this morning, in the next several weeks, we're going to see some of these specific things that God says to us as well. Would you bow with me for a word of prayer as we ask this question today and challenge ourselves to listen for God to speak? Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word and how it reminds us that you are a God who speaks to us. We thank you for your name. In fact, your name speaks to us in many different ways and gives us great understanding about who you are. We think about the name Jesus, and we remember that he is the Savior. He is the promised Messiah, the anointed one who would come. And we praise you as we celebrate around the time of Christmas, reminding ourselves of this truth that you did come. As we look at the passage today, we remember, too, that in the Christmas story that there was a forerunner. His name was John. He became John the Baptist. He was the great preacher who preached and invited and introduced you to the world as you came. And Lord, we think of this great story, and we can see how you broke the silence. Lord, we ask that you would help us to be listening for your voice. Help us to listen today and ask ourselves what it is that you are trying to say to us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. We look at the Word of God today. I want to just show you just four simple thoughts this morning. And as we think about this idea of listening for God to speak, we need to make sure that our ears are open. In fact, the Bible tells us we're supposed to be swift to hear. And I want to encourage you to be swift to hear today. In fact, one of the things, let me just remind you too, around you, if you don't have a Bible this morning, there should be a Bible somewhere around you, and that's our gift to you. Say, it's an early Christmas present. You can have that, and you can write your name in it, and you can take it home with you. And I want to encourage you to read the Bible. In fact, go through these Christmas stories as we focus on them, and we won't be reading all of these verses here, 80 verses in Luke chapter number 1, but I want to encourage you to read through them and see the truth behind what it is that God is trying to say to us at this Christmas time. But you say, well, what was going on? What is the backdrop? We kind of read the end of the story, at least near the end of the story. I want you to take your attention again. We're going to be looking primarily at Luke chapter number 1. So if you have it there, this is the Matthew, Mark, Luke. It's the third book of the New Testament. And again, it's the second book of the Bible that reminds us about the Christmas story and gives us some of the details about it. But the first thing I want to encourage you and remind you about is this. Is when we're listening for God to speak, the first thing that God does, and he shows us in the passage, is this, is that God speaks to our shame. God speaks to our shame. You say, where is that? We look back at Luke chapter number 1, and we're going to skip the first four verses. Drop down to verse number 5. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea. Now, we're going to be talking about King Herod a little bit later. And we think about King Herod and the wise men. You remember that part of the story, which we're not focusing on that this morning. But we can see in the context of time, we can see that he's introduced to us even right here in verse number 5. And there was a certain priest named Zacharias, of the course of Abijah, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. Look at verse number 7. And they had no child, because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. We look there in verse number 7. It reminds us that they did not have any children. In Jewish culture, the families were all praying that God would use them. We look at the prophecies of the Old Testament, and there was a great reminder. There's a great prophecy that he was going to come, the Messiah. Time and time and time again, we can see that there were great prophecies telling us in the Jewish people that Jesus was going to be born. This Messiah was going to be born through, obviously, a Jewish woman. And so when it came to these families, they were very, very excited, one, to have children, and two, to anticipate the Messiah to be born through their family. But when it came to this family, we can see that they had no children. When it came to having children, it was the dream of every Jewish family to have children. And when it came to the story, in fact, it's a great thing that the Bible reminds us in verse number 6, it says they were both righteous before God, because when it came to not having children, other people who were around were quick to judge and ask the question, well, I wonder what kind of a sin it was that Elizabeth or Zacharias had committed in their lives to cause them to not have a child. When it came to not having a child, there was great stigma in the culture in that day and in that time. So when it came to this, there was great barrenness. They considered barrenness to be a result of sin or some great tragedy. And when it came to Elizabeth being barren and unable to have children, it was, we think about it, it was something that she struggled with in her life. In the culture upon which she lived, it was truly an embarrassment because she did not have and was unable to have children, and it was a shame in her life. For a woman to be childless felt like a death sentence was upon her life. That's how dreaded it was in the culture of which Jesus was born into. And here we see Elizabeth and Zacharias, and God did a miracle to cause her and her elderly husband to have a child. Now, I know some of you are sitting here thinking today, you're thinking, I'm too old to have children, right? And not specifically me, I guess, but you, right? Or different things. When it comes to having children, now some of you have had surprises along the way, have you not? And here we can see Elizabeth and Zacharias, they had a surprise that was waiting for them, and God did a miracle, and he provided to them a child in their old age. Two of Elizabeth's ancestors. You can look back and read about Sarah, and you can read about Hannah. We can see that they were also barren, and God brought about a miracle in their lives as well. The Bible reminds us in Galatians 4, 27 and 28, where it's written, "Rejoice, thou barren that bearest not. Break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate hath many more children than she which hath a husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise," the Bible says. So when their son came, they named him John. You say, what in the world does John mean? John means this. It means God has been gracious. God has been gracious. And in this life, oftentimes we have a shame. But let me remind you, when it comes to the shame that we bear, it is not the ability or the inability to have children. This is the shame that we bear in our lives. It is this. It is we are a people of sin. We remember because of our sin, we have shame in our lives. You've heard the expression before that people have skeletons in their closet. Well, understand when it comes to who you and when it comes to who I am, when it comes to reminding who we are, remember that God sent forth his son, Jesus Christ, into this world, and there was going to be a forebear, one who would preach his coming, and his name was John the Baptist. And we remember that God sent John the Baptist because God reminds us that in the midst of our shame, that he sends forth somebody who presents to us the great grace of Almighty God. Jesus ultimately came to take our sin away on the cross of Calvary, and he provides grace to you and to me. And in this story, all through their lives, that God provided great grace to Zacharias and to Elizabeth as well. We remember this truth that grace truly does change everything because God ministers to us, and he speaks to us through our shame. We also remember this, that God speaks to us where God speaks through our silence. Look at verse number 8 again. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course. We're talking about Zacharias, and according to the custom of the priests of office, he was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying about without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zacharias saw him, and he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. Now let me remind you about this. In the context of what's going on, here we find this man, Zacharias, and he's what? He's a priest. Okay, there was about, they estimate about this period of time, there was about 20,000 priests for Israel. When it came to these people, they had different orders, if you will. As we learned earlier, we can see that Zacharias was of the order of Abijah. And when it came to his responsibilities, twice a year, the order of Abijah would be called, and wherever they lived, they would travel into the city of Jerusalem, and they would perform their responsibilities for a week. In order to figure out what they were going to be doing for that week, they would cast lots. And when it came to this specific period of time, we can see that, what did Zacharias get to do? He got to be able to offer incense in the holy place. Now, the holy place was on the inner part of the temple itself. When it came to the holy place, it was not in the Holy of Holies, which is where formerly the Ark of the Covenant sat. But when it came to the Ark of the Covenant, it would sit in the back room, if you will. But the Ark of the Covenant, it had been taken, it had been hidden away. We don't exactly know where the Ark of the Covenant is even to this day. There are different people who claim that they know where it is. Do they? We have no idea. According to different ideas, it's possible that Jeremiah had it hidden. There's a lot of different, or Isaiah, but when it comes to different prophecies and when it comes to different things, we can see and we can speculate, but think about the temple in that day. Here it is. Zacharias comes into the temple to be able to offer the incense, and there was an altar upon which the incense would burn, and there would be then a veil, and on the inside of the veil, that's where the Ark of the Covenant used to be. So here it is, Zacharias comes in, he comes to burn the incense, but remember this, for how many years it is that God had not spoken? 400. 400 years. And by the way, let me remind you, in that period of time, that the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the very presence of God, where it was where once a year that the atonement was made, where God specifically came and he actually spoke to God's people to instruct them and to help them, the Ark of the Covenant was missing. And here it was, Zacharias is coming into a temple that's missing the Ark. He's coming into a temple where God had not spoken for 400 years. And all of a sudden, he's going in, going about the responsibilities and the duties to be able to offer these incense on the altar. And all of a sudden, an angel appeared. Now, how many of you might get a little scared out of your bippy if an angel appeared to you, right? All of a sudden, like, boom! Like, hold on a second. What's going on here? Who are you? I thought I was the only one. You ever went to a room before? And all of a sudden, you turn around and you thought you were alone, but then you realized you weren't. Right? Here is Zacharias, and he is inside the holy place performing the responsibilities that he was called to do, and he's inside the temple, and all of a sudden God breaks his silence. We continue on reading. Verse number 12. When Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. And he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. And he shall go before them in the spirit and power of Elias, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and to the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That's the verses the angel right there is quoting from the book of Malachi 4, where we just read just a moment ago, verse 18. And Zechariah said unto the angel, Whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, that standest in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee and to show thee these glad tidings. Here's an angel. He says this, Hey, I just got done talking to God, and God just gave me a message, and he wanted me to tell you this message. That's the proof. That is the evidence that you need to know that I am going to do something, that God's going to do something. Verse 20, and behold, here's the response. You can imagine. Thou shalt be done. Now, understand the context. This doesn't mean he didn't know things. What this means is he's not going to speak. And not even speak until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. So here we see what happens. Zacharias asks some questions. He said, Hey, how is this going to happen? Right? He's getting up older in age. They've not been able to have a child at this point in time. And he asked a question, and because he doubted, you can see what happened. He was then the response. He was not able to speak. In verse 21, the people waited for Zacharias and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. Hey, let me remind you that when God speaks, it usually takes a little bit of time. I know, sometimes when you get into church, you're like, oh, come on, Pastor, something's going to burn in the oven, right? No, you think about all kinds of things. When it comes to God speaking, we need to let God have some time to speak to us. Basically, what used to happen is, because of the way things happened, they would take the incense, they would bring them in, they would offer them on the altar. Then after the priest was done offering the incense, then he would come quickly out, and he would have a benedictory prayer. And he would pray over the people that were on the outside of the temple. But you can kind of see what happened. He went inside the temple. He's offering the incense, and everybody's waiting outside. They're kind of like looking at their sundials. They're trying to figure out, what time are we going to get done with church today? What happened? You know what happened? God was talking. And God was talking to the people. He was specifically speaking to Zacharias inside the temple. And because of that, it took a little bit of time. How many of you, if an angel started talking to you, how many of you might have a few questions along the way? Zacharias did. Who are you? I'm the angel here. Gabriel? Zacharias knew all about Gabriel. Gabriel was seen many times in the Old Testament. In fact, when it came to the very prophecy of Jesus Christ, we can see that Gabriel brought the message and communicated even to Daniel. And we can see time and again in the Old Testament that Gabriel was communicated about. And in this period of time, we can see that God was going to do something different. We remember where it was, where we can see in the passage, just kind of drop down back into it again. Verse 21, people waited for Zacharias, and people marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not do what? Speak unto them. And they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them and remained speechless. And it came to pass that as soon as the days of his ministration were accomplished, he departed into his own house. And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying, Thus hath the Lord dealt with me in the days wherein he looked on me to take away my reproach among men. So here it is. So the people are waiting on the outside of the temple. Zacharias goes in and offers his sacrifice. He has this lengthy conversation with the angel Gabriel. God tells him what's going to happen. He says this, Hey, you're going to be dumb. You're not going to be able to speak. And so Zacharias comes out of the temple, and he stands before the congregation. It was customary for the priest at this moment in time to offer a prayer. But guess what he didn't do? He didn't pray. How many of you think it would be a little weird? What if I just kind of like came up on the platform and just kind of looked at y'all? What would you do? You can see we offer a terribly awkward silence that was presented by the priest as he came out to do something customary, and because he was breaking custom, because he was not able to speak, all of a sudden the people who were there, and they were trying to look at their watches, trying to figure out when they were going to get out of church, all of a sudden they sat up and they said this, "Hey, God's speaking again." Through our silence, through times of silence, it is this that God will speak. Zacharias' name means this. It means God remembers. And even in those times where we don't think that God is active, let me remind you that you and I are still on his mind, even when you think heaven is being silent. Gabriel tells us that Zacharias that Elizabeth is going to have a baby. Now you can imagine, if you were up in years, you might have a lot of questions for Gabriel, right? We start to ask this, it's kind of a little funny. Zacharias' question ends up being, because of his question, he ends up being a mute. But when Mary asks just a similar question, just across the page in your Bible there, she asks this question. She says, "How shall this be, seeing that I know not a man?" God basically encourages her with an angelic message, but she wasn't caused to be dumb and mute. When it came to this situation, we can see often, it often seems like a long time when we have to wait. We don't like to wait, do we? It's not a fun thing to wait. But in our times of silence, waiting on God, remember this, silence can make us uneasy. You've heard this expression before, the calm before the storm. You've heard before, perhaps, that his silence can speak volumes. Well, the Bible reminds us that Zacharias was unable to speak after talking with Gabriel, and it signaled to the people that God was doing something special. And sometimes we think we need to talk. And by the way, sometimes maybe we think that we need to talk, but really ought not to talk. But it's not unusual for us to doubt or to murmur as God is doing a specific work in our own lives. Let me remind you in Psalm 46:10 that says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth." Because things happen in God's time, not in our time. And the people sat up and they realized this, that God was preparing something special. In fact, in that time of silence, God prepared, he prepared Zacharias. He prepared Elizabeth. He prepared John the Baptist. And God was preparing specifically John the Baptist to be born, to prepare the way for Christ to be preached, and to present Jesus Christ as the Messiah of the world. We can remember this too, that in the silence that God was doing something, he was reminding us that the plan of salvation was still enacted. God had not forgotten his people. God was ushering in a prophet John the Baptist to preach. And we can see in verse number 17, "And he shall go before him in the spirit and the power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready a people prepared for" who? The Lord. Jesus Christ was going to be born, and he is the one who is being prepared. We can see that Jesus Christ is the one who saves us. In fact, we'll be looking at this, the surrounding context of Luke 1 and 2. The surrounding context of Matthew 1 and 2 is the story of Jesus' birth. Jesus works, the God works, through our silence. But thirdly, God speaks through Scripture. God speaks through Scripture. God had revealed earlier that a forerunner to Jesus would come. And the forerunner was going to be like Elijah. Gabriel relates this message from Malachi to John in the book of Luke. Elizabeth's name means this, "God is my oath." Let me remind you, God keeps his word. Does he not? I'm thankful that he does. The word of God is a promise. To God, the promise and the fulfillment are one. Even though for us, there seems to be time in between. Zacharias would have recognized Gabriel's name from the Old Testament scripture where God had met with earlier saints. And even prophecies of the Messiah, which were beginning to unfold before his eyes, some great things were about to happen. And if you want God to speak to your life, let me tell you where you need to go. To his word. So many times people say, "Pastor, if God would just show me a miracle. If God would just speak to me, Let me tell you where he's speaking to you, okay? Let me just put it very, very blunt and very, very straight to the truth. Cut to the chase, rubber meets the road. This is where God speaks to you. Now, from what I hear, there's a lot of people, there's a growing number of people who like to go to horoscopes. That's not where God speaks. A lot of people who like to go to their psychologist or psychiatrist and get some wisdom from them, which, by the way, if you find a good Christian psychiatrist or psychologist, great thing. They can guide you, but where are they going to guide you from? The Word of God. When it comes to wisdom, when it comes to walking with God, when it comes to knowing the truth, let me remind you that God reveals His Word to you. He reveals to you how we ought to live. He reveals the decisions, how you ought to make them through His Word. Romans 1:17, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing how? By the Word of God. If you're going to have faith to trust God, you need to read His Word. Christians, let me remind you why it is so many times we fail. It's because we don't have faith to trust God at His, what? At His Word. We try to do things our way. And when we try to do things our way, that means we're not exercising faith. We're not trusting God's way. Nations and people fail when they lack faith in Almighty God. Hosea 4:6, the first part of the verse says this: My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Well, let me remind you, in the context of what he's saying, that's not just lack of knowledge like 1 + 1 = 2. What he's reminding the people thereof is this, that the people of God are being destroyed because they don't have a knowledge of this book. Let me tell you, if America continues down the path that she is on, she is eventually going to end up in the same trash heap of history that other nations have ended up in. Now, that's not where we want America to be. But I'll tell you what will get us there faster than ever. It is going to be this, forgetting this book. Because the foundation of our nation is built upon the very Word of God. Let me remind you, when it comes to making decisions for your family, if you want to have a strong family, don't just go out and get all the great books that are on the shelf, and they're listed there, and they're great because the New York Times says that they're a bestseller. Let me tell you where you can find strength and help for your family. The Word of God. Amen. You have financial struggles? Go to the Word of God. You have relationship issues? Who doesn't? Go to the Word of God. If you want to find help for life, go to the Word of God. And at Christmas time, we look at the miracles surrounding Jesus' birth, and we hear about the magic of Christmas, but it's wrapped up in the message that is found where? In the Bible. Get in God's Word. The question is then, are you listening to God through His Word? Final truth that we learn today is this. God speaks through our song or story. God speaks through our song or story. You say, where is that recorded in here? Well, in the end, we can see some of the early prophecies that Zacharias and Elizabeth were going to have a son. As we started to read in the passage a little bit later on, and near the end, we can see that, ultimately, that John was born. In those verses that we read, we drop back, and we can see, verse number 16, his mother answered and said, no, not so, but he shall be called John. Why? Because after John was born, before he had his name John, everybody was around saying, hey, we need to name this child Zacharias. Why? Because dad's name was Zacharias. It was just a normal custom. You were Zacharias, your kid was Zacharias, and when Zacharias had kids, guess what? His name was going to be Zacharias, right? It was just a customary thing to name the firstborn son after daddy. And so here it was, Zacharias and Elizabeth, they have a baby, and everybody's around saying, oh, look at little baby Zacharias! And Elizabeth says, no. His name is not Zacharias. His name is going to be called John. Everybody say John. John. That's the name that God specifically picked out. Everybody's like, hold on a second. Elizabeth, Zacharias, you're breaking custom. You're not supposed to name him somebody. There's not even anybody in your family named John. Why would you want to name him that? And it came back. He said, okay. Right, Elizabeth, we know you just had a baby. You're maybe a little stressed out. You picked the name of John. What does your husband say? Let me remind you, for 9 months, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, how many of you say it's a long time not to talk, right? Some of you recently have told me that having laryngitis recently, right? And you have that for a few days. Can you imagine not being able to talk for 9 months? And all of a sudden, They said, okay, John, or not John, but Zacharias, what do you want your child to be doing? They pull over this table, gets a pen out, starts writing, his name shall be called what? John. And as soon as he wrote those words, what happened? He was able to talk. And it was a reminder that God was speaking again. God broke the silence again through the speaking of John. And because Zacharias was able to speak, now we can see in verses 66 to 80, we can see that God uses a specific song, a specific story in the lives of Zacharias and Elizabeth. And we can see the story in verse number 66. Here's what happened. And all they that heard them, well, let me come back to verse number 64. And his mouth was loose, his mouth was open immediately, and his tongue loose, and he spake and praised God. And fear came on all that dwelt around them. And all these sayings were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of Judea. And all that heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, what manner of child shall this be? And the hand of the Lord was with him. Verse 67. And his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied. Remember, the people hadn't heard a prophecy in how many years? 400 years. And here's the first prophecy. The first psalm, the first message communicated by God. In verse number 68, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware to our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. And thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, and was in the deserts till the day of his showing unto Israel. You know, this past week, we had a great opportunity to have a time of thanksgiving, to be able to express and to be able to communicate through our lives, through our verbiage, what it is that we were thankful for that God has done in our lives. And when you take steps of faith to follow the Lord according to his word, then God speaks through your life to share and to reinforce God's word to observers and those who hear your song and your life. The fact is, in life, I've seen people take one of two different paths. Choosing to follow God or not to follow God. As a pastor, as your Sunday school teachers know, and different people, when it comes to being in leadership, our responsibilities. One of them is to help people to move forward, how? In faith. Trusting what? God's word, right? And so when it comes to those opportunities of helping people to take those steps, remember, we have a great opportunity, but it's a sad time when Christians choose not to move forward, and they choose not to follow God. But it's an exciting time when someone prays about something and chooses to take that step of faith. By the way, how many of you know this? When you take a step of faith, oftentimes it is outside of your comfort zone, right? God says, hey, this is what I want you to do. And you're like, I've never done that before. Well, what does God want you to do? And when it comes to listening to God and following God's path for life, we can see that Elizabeth and Zacharias took a step, a huge step of faith. In fact, sometimes we look at God challenging us to take the step of faith and it gets uncomfortable. But how many of you know this too? Sometimes in your mind you just think, well, that's just impossible. God can't do that with me. The exciting thing is this. Every time God encourages you to take a step by faith, he always equips you to be able to take that step of faith. And God is always there to with you as you take that step of faith. People say they don't get anything out of church when they choose not to listen with a heart of faith. Oftentimes people get critical and they backslide. But Zacharias and Elizabeth had an amazing story because they chose to take steps of faith. Right? If you want to grow in Jesus Christ, how many of you just want to get a book and read about all the people who backslid in the Lord? They're no longer walking with Jesus. But you know what I get excited about? I can take you up to my bookshelf in my office, and I can point out different biographies, and I can show you how one person after another person after another person, you know what they did? They took steps of faith, and because of their faith, they found opportunities in God, and God used them in a mighty way to be able to lead somebody to Christ, to be able to preach a sermon, to teach a Sunday school class, to be able to be faithful to church. And when it came to people taking steps of faith, let me ask you this question. God is speaking, and God is trying to help you to take steps of faith. So how about you? What is God speaking to you about? What is your next step of faith? Perhaps it's getting up a little earlier to get poked into a Sunday school class. It does take a little bit of faith, does it not? Maybe it's sharing your salvation testimony with a coworker or a family member. Maybe it's giving a full tithe or stretching to give offerings to God every time you get paid. Maybe it's becoming and volunteering and saying, hey, Sunday school teacher, whoever that may be for your class, saying, could I be an assistant teacher? Could I help you out in some way for your Sunday school class? Maybe this will be a big step of faith for some of you to help in the nursery. Amen. What about taking time to fast and to pray? Even at Christmas time when we're expected to eat all this sugar, right? What about in our lives going perhaps on a missions trip and seeing how God can work through you? Maybe it's committing to give God every area of your life, or perhaps setting aside at least an hour, just 1 hour every week to serve God at your church. And there's many other things that God can speak to us about. The question is what is God speaking to you about right now? In fact, one of the great testimonies that we have modeled before us is one that we celebrated even this morning and this week. We think about Pastor Brandon and his life. I remember when I knew him as a much younger version of himself. But I remember as a college student how he continued to take steps of faith. Was everything perfect as he chose to follow God? And was all the earthly things put together just the way that he would imagine it, or I would imagine it, or you would imagine it? No. But time and time and time again, God led him and directed him as he took those steps of faith. Ultimately, at some point, as he was in Olathe and got to meet his wife, and they finally started to date, and eventually they got engaged and then get married. 2 weeks later, they ended up in Louisiana. Pretty amazing story. Do you know how that happened? Faith. How many of you know this? The greatest stories are born out of faith, not trying to get things our own way. Let me encourage you to take those steps of faith. Question for us today is this, and I conclude with this question. Are you listening for God's speech? Listen. That oftentimes involves us making sure that we're quiet to hear what God's trying to say. In the midst of all the hustle and bustle and the busyness of all that is going on, here's the question. What is God saying to you? As we examine that question, let me encourage you to take a step of faith to follow God today. Would you bow with me for a word of prayer this morning? Your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed. I'm going to ask you just a couple of questions to follow up on that question I just asked you. What is it that God's speaking to you about? In the first place, let me ask you a question. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, let me remind you that's the one thing that God is trying to speak to you about today. He's trying to get your attention so that you can know that you have a relationship with Him, so that you would be saved, and that you would one day have that relationship with Him and have a home in heaven. If I were to ask you this morning, do you know Jesus Christ? Do you have a home in heaven? And are you sure that you have that relationship? Many of you could raise your hand. Maybe you're here this morning, and if I ask that question, do you know that you're saved? Do you know that you're on your way to heaven? If you have any doubt at all, you know, the Holy Spirit probably knocking on your heart's door right now, and He's asking that question, would you like to know me? Perhaps you're here this morning, and you say, yes, I would like to know God as my Savior. I'd like Jesus to be my Savior this morning. Would you please pray for me? That's what God is speaking to me about today. I'm going to look across the auditorium, and that's what God is talking to you about this morning. Would you put your hand up? Wait till I see it. Any at all, looking across the auditorium, trying to see your hand Anybody at all? Yes, God speaking to me. I want to know Jesus as my Savior. He's speaking to me about that right now. This morning, Christians, let me ask you a question. What is it that God's working in your life? Some of you might say this. It's been a while since I've been listening. You're getting in God's word. Are you praying? And by the way, let me remind you, sometimes God doesn't give you some new instructions until you do what? You take a step of faith with the instructions he's already given you. What is God speaking to you about today? I can't pretend to know what's on your mind and your heart this morning. Maybe it's, as I mentioned, being in Sunday school, being faithful to church, perhaps it's giving, or there's a number of different things that you can do. I'm not going to pretend to guess today, but how many of you would lift your hand and say this? Yes, God is speaking to me today. I'm recognizing his voice, and there are some steps of faith that I need to take. Would you put your hand up there? Let me pray for you. Say, yes, God's speaking to me. I'm recognizing that he's doing so, and I need to take some steps of faith. Anybody know? Appreciate that hand. Appreciate that hand. Give those hands this morning. Let me encourage you. Let's take those steps of faith this morning. Would you stand where you are? I want to pray for you this morning, and as I begin to pray, I encourage you to step out. I encourage you to get along with God. If you need to be saved, just step out. I'll be right here in the front. Do very, very simple. Say, Pastor, I need to be saved. And we'll show you from the Bible how you can be saved today. If you're a Christian, you say, yes, there are some things that I need to do, some steps of faith that I need to take. We encourage you, maybe just step forward and take a step of faith. Say this, God, help me to take that step of faith today and follow you this morning. Let's pray. Let's let God do that work in our lives. Lord, I thank you for the hands that were lifted, the hearts that are touched right now as you're continuing to speak to our lives. Lord, help us to trust you and help us to follow you. Lord, this morning we remember that we need to have eyes of faith as we trust you. Lord, help us to remember that your word is constant. It is a promise. It is an oath, just like Elizabeth's name meant. Lord, help us to follow you today. Help us to take those steps of faith to follow you this morning. Lord, as you reveal that first step, we know that you'll reveal the next step, the next step. Help us be faithful to take those steps as we follow you each and every day. But help today to be the beginning. We ask this in Jesus' name. And if God's speaking to you, let me encourage you, take that step of faith. Let's follow Christ with our lives today.
Faith promise missions.
But let's go, Lord, in word of prayer as we receive the offering this morning. Dear God, we thank you today that we can worship you, Lord. And I pray as we come together and we've looked at your word and understand the story here and what it means to listen to you speak and to speak through the silence and to follow you, Lord. I pray that you'll help us this season and through the year to follow your voice, to work in our lives, and to have your will and way. We love you, Jesus. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. And then this week, Tuesday morning, we have men's prayer breakfast at 8:30. Thursday, we have ladies' night out. So there was a place to mark on your connecting card. If you didn't, that's okay. Just let Miss Amy Sue know or the Welcome Center on your way out today what you plan on bringing. But it's going to be this Thursday at 7 o'clock. Be a good time of food, fellowship, and time in God's Word. It says that you can bring a finger food or a dessert to share. So if you'd like to bring something for that, 7 o'clock this Thursday night, a ladies' night out. And then don't forget Friday, we have our glad cleaning. And then I know several of our Sunday school classes have some parties going on, and we'll try to keep you up to date on those. One of those is this Saturday at 6 o'clock. We have the His Design Christmas Party class. And so if you'd like information about that, we welcome you to attend that. And then also, if you need information on our Sunday school, we'd love to get you involved in a class. And this is a great time to get connected with people during the Christmas season. And then also in your bulletin, so tonight we have our prayer meeting, and then also our church business meeting. We have a couple busy Sunday nights coming up. Next Sunday night, you get to hear our school elementary present the Christmas shoe tree. And so I know you'll enjoy the program. It is a lot of fun, okay? And then on top of that, we are partnering with Souls for Souls. And so if you have any gently used shoes or you'd like to bring some new shoes to donate, we'll have baskets out in the foyer. You can bring those. You can drop them off for the program. And then we're going to be sending those to that organization. And they'll be able to help someone that is in need of shoes this Christmas season. So and it goes along well with the program. So you kind of see a little bit of that. But be here next Sunday night at 6 o'clock for that. And then the next Sunday is our Christmas celebration service at 6 o'clock. We have invite cards in the foyer, so you can take those with you. It's very easy to pass out and let someone know. That evening, our choir is going to be presenting music, as well as we'll have some small drama going along with that. Following that service, we'll have Christmas cookies and snow to play in, and it'll be a great time of fellowship. So invite someone to be here for that Christmas service, 6 o'clock, December 15th. I went back, there's one song that we're going to use our children in for that Christmas. And so I practiced with them this morning. Next week I have a letter for you. We'll just ask them to be here at our Thursday night rehearsal, which is on the 12th. We'll give you information on that, but we'll be running through it on Sunday mornings to get them prepared for that as well. And then there's some information there about our offering envelopes. If you're interested in getting tithing envelopes, I know many of you give in different ways. Some of you use those envelopes each week you bring in and put it in there and place it off the plate. Some of you give online. But if you are interested in receiving that packet of envelopes to give throughout the year, just let us know. You can mark on the connecting card or just contact our church office. And then one more thing, let me remind you about Christmas cards. We'll have that box available out there for you to pass those out. If you'd like to send Christmas cards to other church members, we'll have that alphabetical order. You can just bring that, place that in there. Also, there are church directories available for you on that if you'd like to get a copy of that. And then the tree out here that was very well decorated this Friday, we had several volunteers come in and do a great job on that. We call that our memory tree. We started this, probably about 15 years ago, because many of us, although it's an exciting time at Christmas, we often feel the absence of someone. And so we invite you, if you have an ornament or you'd like to place an ornament on the tree just to recognize someone that's meant something to you in your life, you can bring that, place that on the tree, maybe put a tag with their name on it, and then that way we can just observe them through the Christmas season. So that is a memory tree that's available for you to use, and I know I often enjoy going around looking at several of the ornaments and just remembering some people, even that meant something to me in my life here. So again, there's several things going on. Invite someone. Takes a stack of those Christmas invite cards and pass those out. It also has information about our Christmas Eve service that's coming and our New Year's Eve service as well. Well, would you stand with me? We'll close with a word of prayer. Again, yes, thank you so much for being here. Would you please stop by and visit with Pastor in the foyer? He'd love to have the opportunity to greet you and just to get to know you a little bit. And we hope you'll come back and visit with us again soon. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you today for just the good time in your house of studying your word and lifting you up in praise. And Lord, I pray as we go out this week, Lord, that you'll encourage our hearts, Lord, that we'll walk close to you, Lord, and that you'll use us to minister to someone if we come across their path. Lord, I pray it for tonight's service. You'll bring us back safely for that, and that you'll just continue to use our ministry. Thank you for those that could be here with us today, Lord, and I pray that they truly heard from you this morning and that you've spoken to their hearts. And I pray you bless us as we dismiss. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.